Hello friends, welcome to Science Land. I am Nikita and today we are going to talk about Montreal Protocol. Let me start with an introduction of the same. Montreal Protocol is also known as Montreal Protocol on substances that deplete the ozone layer. This protocol was signed in the year 1987. Montreal Protocol is like a baby of another convention, which is known as the Vienna Convention for the Protection of the Ozone Layer. Now, this convention was signed 17-18 months approximately before Montreal Protocol was signed, which is in the year 1985. Montreal Protocol is an international environmental agreement or a treaty. It was designed to stop the production of ODS and its concentration in the atmosphere to help protect ozone layer. Now, ODS are certain chemicals which break the ozone molecule, and hence the name ODS, ozone depleting substances. If the ozone is broken down, harmful UV rays can easily penetrate and it can have adverse effects on human beings. Now, because ozone layer is very important, 197 countries have signed this protocol, making Montreal Protocol achieve universal ratification status. Universal ratification meaning Montreal Protocol is accepted by all the countries around the globe. Therefore, it is considered to be the most successful environment protection treaty. This was the introduction. Let me start with the history of Montreal Protocol. In early 1973, two American chemists, Rowland and Molina, gave a reaction of how ozone molecule is destroyed. I have discussed that reaction in my previous video. If you want, you can check that video out. A year later, in 1974, they got their work published in Nature Journal. In 1976, the US National Academy of Science confirmed the scientific credibility of their hypothesis in a report. That's when, in 1978, CFC-based aerosols were banned in certain countries, namely US, Norway, Sweden, and Canada. In 1985, the ozone hole over Antarctica was discovered. This study was done by British Antarctica Survey and they published their report in Nature Journal. The report essentially validated their hypothesis, and that's when everyone was scared. That's why on 22nd March 1985, the Vienna Convention for the Protection of Ozone Layer came into existence. Initially, it was signed by just 20 nations. This convention served two purposes. First, to promote cooperation amongst countries to exchange information about effects of human activities on ozone layer. And second, to provide a framework, the foundation of the CFC controlling protocol. That's when 17-18 months later, Montreal Protocol was signed on 16th September 1987. Because it was signed on 16th September, 16th September every year is celebrated as International Ozone Day. On 1st January 1989, the Montreal Protocol entered into force. And in 1995, these two brilliant people got Nobel Prize for their work. That was the history of Montreal Protocol. Let me talk about how actually Montreal Protocol works. It sets out a mandatory timetable to phase out ODS. It's like when you work in a laboratory and you work with an instrument, a particular SOP is given for that instrument. In a similar fashion, a timetable is given to reduce the ODS consumption in phases. This timetable sets binding progressive phase out obligation on the parties, meaning it will ask a particular party to reduce a particular ODS consumption slowly and steadily. First, you reduce the ODS consumption by 25%, then maybe 75%, and then completely freeze the consumption by reducing it to 100%. That's how it gives progressive phase out timetable. Montreal Protocol targets 96 to 100 ozone depleting substances. This timetable is revised regularly. Now, why this revision? Because this revision is in accordance to scientific advances or technological inventions. It's like a student's syllabus getting upgraded. Why would a textbook get upgraded? Essentially, because the Department of Education maybe wants to incorporate new information, maybe revise the practical or something of that sort, right? So the existing timetable or the protocol which was given earlier is revised as and when there is any scientific or technological invention. Apart from this main function of binding to the timetable, there are other responsibilities of the parties. Few of these responsibilities are control of ODS trade. Now, as a nation, I can either import the ODS or export the ODS. That needs to be in limit. For keeping a track of how much ODS is associated to a nation, there are systems which are known as national licensing systems. These systems are like, there is this license which is given for import of ODS to a particular agency or export of ODS, and theoretically a nation knows in advance how much ODS is either exported or imported in the country. Apart from that, the main important responsibility is data reporting. Now, this data needs to be reported on annual basis to Ozone Secretariat. What does Ozone Secretariat do? That we'll discuss later in the video. But mainly how data is reported, it's by following a particular formula. ODS consumption is equal to ODS production plus ODS import minus the ODS export. Because there is no space, I have written the initials, but it means that a nation can produce its own ODS, it can import minus the exported amount is the total ODS consumption of a particular nation. That needs to be reported annually. Now, there are meetings which occur on a regular basis. These meetings are also known as amendments. These amendments strengthen the Montreal Protocol. I'll explain you how. Like, the second meeting was held in London in 1990, fourth in Copenhagen 1992, seventh in Vienna 1995, ninth in Montreal 1997, 11th in Beijing 1999, 28th in Kigali 2016. But why these meetings or amendments important? Let's say in the second meeting, CFCs were in the timetable to phase out. Later in the ninth meeting, HCFCs were added to the protocol, giving a particular timetable for HCFCs to phase out. In 28th meeting, HFCs, hydrofluorocarbon, they are potent greenhouse gas, they are scheduled to phase out. We will talk about Kigali amendment in detail now. Kigali amendment is important because it is aimed to reduce the consumption and production of HFCs, hydrofluorocarbon, in next 30 years. HFCs are potent greenhouse gases which are 100 to 1000 times more potent than CO2, which contributes to global climate change. HFCs emission is projected to increase by 20x in next decade because there will be increase in demand for refrigerations, ACs or air condition in developing countries. Therefore, Kigali Amendment also provides financing to certain countries so that they can transition to more climate friendly alternatives. There are certain key elements of Kigali Amendment. First, ambition phase down schedule. Even if it is a developed country or developing country, the phase down schedule is quite ambitious. Incentives given if a nation takes early action than the proposed schedule. And third, the structure of the schedule is flexible and innovative. So, if Kigali Amendment is implemented successfully, it is estimated that it will reduce 80 million metric tons of CO2 equivalent emission by 2050, thereby avoiding 0.5 degrees Celsius warming up by next decade. So that's why Kigali Amendment is important. Okay, so now let's talk about the timetable which is given by the Montreal Protocol. This timetable, which is daunting, is also known as control measures. Essentially, the Article 2 of Montreal Protocol. You need not remember the entire timetable. It's just for your understanding that I've drawn and now I'm explaining you. Certain things to remember. The developed countries are known as non-Article 5 countries. Similarly, developing countries are known as Article 5 countries. There are the ODS which I've written. Some have been phased out long back and the others are right now in the phasing out schedule. There are three more ODS which are phased out, but because there is less space, I have not mentioned the details of the same. So let's start. CFC phased out by the end of 1995 in developed countries. In developing countries, phased out by end of 2010. Halons phased out by 1993. In developing countries, by end of 2010. Carbon tetrachloride phased out by 1995. Year by 2010. Methyl chloroform phased out by 1995 in developed countries. Similarly, in developing countries by 2015. There are certain ODS which are HCFCs, hydrochlorofluorocarbon, and HFCs, the hydrofluorocarbon. Both are right now in phasing out schedule. HCFCs relate to Montreal Amendment. And HFCs relate to Kigali Amendment, and that's why they are important. So HFCs, the timetable is such that for developed countries, by 2020 end, it should be 100% reduced. For developing countries, 35% reduction by 2020. Now, there are certain technicalities which are involved at times. Like for example, here I've written 1996. It means that the consumption level of 1996 should be freezed, like the starting point, and from there the 35% should be further reduced by 2004. That is the meaning of freezing at a particular level in that year. For developing countries, it should be freezed in 2013 by taking the average of 2009 and 2010 and further reducing by 10% till end of 2015. Similarly, HFCs, the timetable is given. So by end of 2036, at least 85% should be reduced in developed countries. Similarly, here the freeze level is given. Freeze consumption by the year 2024. And from there onwards, 10% decrease by 2029. 30% reduction by 2035, 50% reduction by 2040, and 80% reduction by 2045. So, Kigali Amendment essentially aims to reduce at least 80 to 85% of HFCs by approximately 2045 year. The only thing we need to keep in mind is less time is given for developed countries to phase out particular ODS. And more time is given for developing countries. You can check in every particular ODS. 1995, 2015, 2020, 2030. This extra time is given because they lag in certain advancements, technology, money, lot of stuff. And apart from this, there are three more compounds which are already phased out. Methyl bromide, hydrobromofluorocarbon and bromochloromethane. These all are already phased out, but I've not mentioned the details of it. Okay, so now let's talk about an important aspect of Montreal Protocol, which is multilateral fund. Multilateral fund was made for implementation of Montreal Protocol. It was established in the year 1990 during the second meeting of Montreal Protocol, which was held in London. It began its working in 1991 under Article 10 of Montreal Protocol. Aim is to provide financial and technical assistance to Article 5 countries, which are essentially the developing countries. Article 5 countries, by definition, here for this protocol, are countries whose annual per capita consumption and production of ODS is less than 0.3 kg, so that they can comply with the control measures of the protocol. Now, the activity of multilateral fund is given to four international agencies, which are United Nations Environment Programme, United Nations Development Programme, World Bank, United Nations Industrial Development Organization, as well as there are some bilateral agencies of non-Article 5 countries. The responsibility for overseeing the activity and the operation of the fund rests with a committee which is known as Executive Committee. This committee is comprised of 7 members from Article 5 countries and 7 members of non-Article 5 countries. In the year 2020, India is the member of the Executive Committee. Now, Executive Committee is assisted by Multilateral Fund Secretariat, which is located in Montreal. So, this was the important thing associated with Montreal Protocol. Okay, so now let's talk about two important terms and conclude today's lecture. The first is SAP, Scientific Assessment Panel. This Scientific Assessment Panel assesses the status of the depletion of the ozone layer. This is done after it sees how well the Montreal Protocol has been implemented, the data it is receiving from the various nations. A report is generated by this panel every 3 to 4 years, and there are hundreds of scientists in this panel to assess the data. There is another term, which is Ozone Secretariat. The Ozone Secretariat is a secretariat to both Vienna Convention and Montreal Protocol. It is a secretariat under Article 7 of Vienna Convention and Article 12 of Montreal Protocol. Now, what are the functions of Ozone Secretariat? It arranges meeting of different bodies, like meeting of parties or open-ended working group or the conferences. Everything it will arrange. It will also monitor the implementation of both Vienna Convention and Montreal Protocol. Ozone Secretariat has its office in Nairobi, Kenya. So that's the end of Montreal Protocol. If you like the video, please like, share and subscribe. Thank you so much for watching. Bye-bye.